Hello and welcome to MCTV. I'm Cameron Jones, and today I'm here with Dr. Eric Pratt, the Vice President for Christian Development at MC. So, Dr. Pratt, there's been a lot of conversation about chapel lately here on campus. Can you just explain to us the purpose of chapel?
A chapel is the only shared experience for traditional undergraduates where they get the opportunity to be challenged to get to know Christ, and to, if they already know Him, to walk with Him more consistently, and to make decisions in their life that will reflect His purposes and, I guess, His glory.
Okay. So, how, moving forward, are we going to change chapel to make it more effective, to help it serve its purpose better? What are some ideas for that?
Well, I mean, we have a number of ideas. We work with a student team to try to put together chapels that will connect with students, but having 1,100 people in one class from different denominations, backgrounds, countries, perspectives, makes it difficult to have a one-size-fits-all mentality. And so we work very hard to have a variety of opportunities to challenge students in a different way. Sometimes it's going to be a direct gospel message. Sometimes it's going to be more of, hey, let's begin this conversation without resolving it to get students to do more. Sometimes it's a performance. Sometimes, even this semester, it was an art demonstration, how to share the gospel through art.
So can you talk about some of the issues that chapel has faced this semester?
One of the primary issues that chapel faced this semester is we have students who signed in and left, and the only requirement for chapel is that you be there. I mean, they can miss as many experiences as they actually want, but they need to make 10 and stay for 10 if they're going to get credit. And when students sign in and then leave and they're not there, that's actually amounts to academic dishonesty, you know, and also lying to a university official, all those things that are in the student handbook. And so when I chose a single date, which we do each semester, just let's double check attendance in chapel with card use other places for those who are supposed to be in chapel. And we have over 20% of the students have signed in and then used their card during the chapel experience, either in the residence hall or in the cafeteria, there's an issue. So we worked hard to sort of say, hey guys, look, this is not only wrong, but we will have to do something. I mean, as an official of the university, if I know something's happening and I don't basically make record of it or come forward about it, then that shows a lack of integrity on my part.
Right. So in response to students' lack of integrity, a video was shown in chapel on April 12th of students who had skipped chapel.
No, actually, that wasn't what the video was.
Oh, okay. Well.
The video, and again, it was good in process, poor in execution. That Tuesday morning, I was going to be there, and before any of the SGA induction ceremony or things of that sort, I was going to briefly make one final appeal to the students to say, look, men and women, you're constantly being watched on this campus and other places. There's 200 cameras that are around for your safety. Okay? We just want to remind you that you need to come forward and do the right thing. Okay? So here are some examples of just people leaving chapel. None of these would be people skipping chapel. These are just people leaving chapel. And then here are some other pictures of people's card swipes during the cafeteria when they should be in chapel. And it was supposed to happen in about a 30-second framework. But I had the flu, and so Grant Gillum was willing to do that, even though he knew basically what the video was about, but didn't know all the pictures and the slides that were contained. And instead of doing it beforehand, because of some technical issues with some students that were there working for us, it didn't get done till the end of chapel. And also, it went much more slowly than it should have been. It should have been just very quickly, just very said, hey guys, come on, do the right thing.
Okay, well, how big of a problem is chapel attendance? Like, for example, what are the percentages of students who attend?
Well, percentages as of what? How they should attend? I mean, every student's required to attend.
Right.
Yeah, semesters. Now, typically, on a semester, we may have 5 to 10% of students who don't get credit for chapel. They just failed to get their 10 chapel experiences in. And often, some of those are just one or two short, and we work with them whether through community service or other aspects, to obtain those 10 experiences. But as far as attendance-wise, I guess for the most part, it's pretty consistent.
Okay, well, so I do have to ask, do you think that it was the best idea to show that video on the day of SGA induction?
It was the only day that we could. SGA induction is a regular chapel experience, and that is a chapel schedule, and we allow SGA to have their induction ceremony because we think it's an important worship experience when students come into a position of leadership for the college and are representing the students. But that's still a regular chapel experience.
Okay, so going forward, how will we address the problem of chapel skipping?
Well, we are working out ways to be more, I guess, student-friendly as it comes to signing in and signing out. And the only reason we have to sign in and sign out is because of the issue of skipping. You know, if we felt like that students were consistent and would show up and stay there, then we would either scan afterwards or scan before. But this semester we had technical issues with the scanning equipment, and so that led to a more lengthy sign-in, sign-out process. And we were trying to give students back time so they didn't have to sign out. Even though the latest that a student stayed when we signed out was 11:53, which still gave them 7 minutes to get to their next class.
So some students do feel humiliated in wake of the video. Mm-hmm. How will you go about in building them up as far as Christian development goes?
Well, first we need to know who they are, and we've met with a number of students. And we've told them openly that it wasn't our intention to humiliate. It was our intention to encourage them to come do the right thing if they did things that were unethical. And so for us, it's a matter of, look, maybe it didn't come across the way we intended, and we're sorry, but you know, we all make mistakes. And part of that making mistakes is if I'm in a class of 35, you know, and working with students and I call somebody out, that's really not a big deal. And that happens every day in class here with professors. It just happens that I have a class of 1,100, and that anytime I call somebody out, that's actually one of the reasons for chapel, so that whatever happens, a majority of the students can respond to it and react to it. It just happens that what happened this time was not something that was appreciated by the students.
So, do you think that this was the most effective way of handling the problem?
Under the situation, now, if we could go back and redo things, we might do it differently. But for this, it was very effective because after that incident, we had over 95 people come forward and say, oh, you know, I actually did sign in and leave, and I want to get credit for chapel, and I don't want to be written up for disciplinary process.
So how would you do it differently if you could go back?
I don't know, because part of it is, if I could not be sick, that would probably have stemmed most of the problem, because we would have had control during that situation. But Dr. Mastard had already planned to be out. That was scheduled months ago. And you can't help an illness. And unlike another class where if the professor is sick, you cancel it, we can't do that because of the experiences and how chapel is recorded and how people get credit for it. It's just being there. There's not a test. There's not a paper.
So overall, what was the student reaction like towards the video?
For the most part, it wasn't positive. But in some ways, it had its desired effect because a lot more people did not have to go through a disciplinary process. And they did step up and say, you know what, I did this and I'm sorry.
About how many students did step up?
Well, overall, and this is just a classroom issue, we'll say that we had well over 200 students who said they signed in and left and came forward, and many others are being turned in for their lack of integrity in this process and for violating student code of conduct.
Turned in by whom?
Well, they're turned in by our office, because if we know that they did something wrong, and we don't turn it in, then that goes against what my job description is, just with making sure that I follow the policies and procedures of the university.
So are you concerned that this might come off as a witch hunt?
No, because it's not a witch hunt. If it were a witch hunt, I would have told anybody anything and just turned in 300 students, and then we would probably have 30 students who are planning to graduate who won't even have that opportunity. So we're trying to encourage students to do the right thing, not a witch hunt. If it were a witch hunt, then we could every week in chapel or everything, we could just really be very definitive about what students are doing and not doing. But instead, we try to create an experience that will connect with a different group or a large percentage of the students each week so they can be engaged.
Do you think that this has damaged the reputation of chapel's spiritual development qualities?
In some ways it may, but in other ways, I hope that students will look beyond the surface and see what we're trying to do by encouraging students to live up to the values that Mississippi College stands for. And integrity and faithfulness are really two of those things. And if they don't respond accordingly, then we have issues on a larger scale, not just of what's taking place in chapel, because students are going to dislike aspects of chapel. Any type of compulsion, they're going to complain about. And it's a lot easier to complain about something when you're not meeting face to face with a professor in a small room, you know, when you're basically anonymous. And you can say, well, I don't like this, or I don't want to do this. And it's like, it's a core requirement. It was here long before I was here, and it should be here long after I'm here, because it is one of the primary ways that we encourage students, and one of the primary ways that the school fulfills its mission and vision to be committed to the cause of Christ and helping students grow in their walk with Christ. And in some ways, chapel's been very effective in that even this year in chapel, 22 students in the chapel period have made first-time professions of faith, and we've been able to follow up with those students. And we've had other students come after experiences and all to talk, to receive counsel, to say, okay, how do I get involved, or I'd like to commit myself to this, what can I do? So in some ways, will this experience hurt chapel? Maybe, but I think for the most part, every year is different, expectations are different, and actually the way the semesters play out are different, and the students are different. You don't have the same group every year.
Okay, so how do you think that we could make chapel more efficient as far as the sign-in in and out process? Will there be more scanners?
Well, we were working on that. There are different apps that we can use on smartphones that we're looking at. We're looking at proxy readers, like what's in the dorm entrance and exit. But we don't know. At other schools that have chapel, same with us, that are compelled to do it, it's compulsory, there are different ways to do that. The most efficient and effective way is the least student friendly, and that is having assigned seats with somebody at the end of the row taking roll each week.
Okay. Well, do you have any final thoughts?
No, I mean, I appreciate you talking with us and sharing with us and looking to get to the, I guess, crux of the story. I mean, there would have been another way to look at this as far as chapel experience or other things of if you put this in the context of a classroom, you know, it would have been a cheating scandal, not a chapel issue. It would have been, you know, hundreds of students cheat or violate school policy. What's the school's response going to be?
All right. Well, thank you so much. We really appreciate you coming by to talk with us. Thank you. So be sure to join us next time on MCTV.